I do not believe that any kind of broadband antibiotic that will deal with every situation in every church in America and in England and in Scotland and wherever else there are. What we will need from God is a specific word of His grace to the church at Ephesus, or to the church at Sardis, or to the church in Pennsylvania, the church, I don't know, your hometown. What's your hometown? Okay, that place. Or the church in this place. This kind of generalization, I think it produces a kind of a woolly thinking. And we begin to think, well, what the trouble of the church is this and this. But I'll tell you what I'm saying. When I spoke at Canton last year at this conference, I took in my topic Psalm 51 and I talked about personal revival. You know about Psalm 51 as you can look it up and find out. Now I want to talk about the church, the local church, as an agent for revival. I want to talk about the local church being responsible, and I'll tell you why. It has to do with accountability. You see, no one is accountable for this thing that we call the church in America or the church in Scotland. No one is accountable. No one is going to, on one day, stand before God and be required to give an account of the way that they care for the church in Scotland. But the church in Greenwich, or the church in Reading, where I come from, or the church in wherever it is, there are going to be people who are going to have to give an account. The letter to the Hebrews says, trust your leaders, for they watch for your souls, as those who have to give an account. I'm thinking about accountability. What I'm really doing is this. I want to say, whose responsibility is it to do something about the church? Is it your responsibility? I know when we're kind of very young Christians, we sometimes get some wonderful ideas that, you know, we're going to kind of take the world up all on our own, and we're going to raise the dead, and we're going to do all sorts of things. And I've been in family meetings where you've got youngsters. And maybe they're in their late teens like this, and they're really fervent from there. They're coming against the spirit of Islam. And I think, the Lord bless them. It's not likely that this 17-year-old is going to be given authority to give come against the spirit of Islam. But God knows their heart, and I'm not criticizing, I'm not disparaging them. I'm just simply saying that in the Bible, you'll understand that God, when He gives responsibility, He expects accountability. He expects people to say what they've done or what they've entrusted you. You are not responsible for what you've not got. Is it what Paul says to the Corinthians? He says it's required of a man, not that a man gives according to what he doesn't have, but that he gives according to what he does have. In other words, what God has put into your hands, He will hold you responsible for. You will have to give an account for it. But you will not have to give an account for what God has not put into your hands. And the way that the New Testament looks at the church of God is not in some great kind of bend, but actually church by church by church by church. There was a whole area called Galatia that had been sucked into what Paul called the bewitching. He says, you've been bewitched. They had taken into their understanding a fake gospel. I'm not, you know what the letters to the Galatians are all about. But the interesting thing is that when Paul writes to, he writes to the churches in Galatia. He doesn't write to the church in Galatia. Because biblically, there's no such thing as the church in Galatia. There's only the churches in Galatia. When Paul says that when he was first converted and he went to Jerusalem, he said people hadn't seen him, but the churches in Judea had heard what had happened to him. He doesn't say the church in Judea. He said the churches in Judea. Are you getting this? God's unit of responsibility on earth is the local church. That is awesome. That's an American word, I know, but we'll use it just this once. That is an amazing responsibility. You are personally responsible for the things that God puts into your life and the way that you use them. But there's another level of accountability, but it's the local church. And there's nothing beyond that. This is why originally the Bible days in the less extinguished as monarchical territorial bishops over vast areas, it couldn't function like that. Because the ultimate level of authority and responsibility is a local church. And what John sees now is he sees the first thing he sees as he turns, he sees these seven separate lampstands, golden ones. And of course, you would have known the pattern of Israel of old. Israel of old had a seven-branched lampstand. All the English Bible is often called candlesticks, but they weren't actually candlesticks. There were no candles in the Bible. Candles are created by congealed fat, and they are very finite in their burning ability. The lamps in the Bible weren't candles, they were lamps, and the reservoirs could be replenished so that they could burn forever. There's nothing limited in the way that God does things. So these were kind of lampstands, and on the seventh, there were seven little shelves, effectively, in the holy place, in Israel's tabernacle. And on each one of those little shelves, there was a lamp and a candle. And although it was the responsibility of the people of Israel to bring every day fresh pressed olives, and the oil from them that was beaten out that day, it had to be the best, it had to be pure. When they brought it, if you read the scriptures carefully, you'll discover that they put it into the hands of Aaron. Because Aaron was charged with the unique responsibility of tending to that lamb. Aaron, not even his sons. Aaron. It was Aaron's responsibility to trim the wick and to make sure the clear testimony shone. It was Aaron's responsibility to make sure that the little reservoir was filled with oil. That lamp was intended to burn forever. There was to be no flickering in there, no sputtering, no guttering candles. This was to be a constant, steady line, and it was Aaron's responsibility. Let me give you a kind of code and see where I'm going. That to say, it was the responsibility of the high priest. It was the high priest's responsibility to keep the light clean and shining. It is still the responsibility of the high priest to keep the light clean and shining. What John sees is he sees the high priest, not Israel's high priest. Israel's high priest had the names of Israel written across their chest and on their shoulders. This high priest has a golden band around. I sometimes think maybe he didn't need names written on his chest because they're written on his hands. But this isn't like Israel's high priest. This is a different kind of high priest. But he's still functioning as a high priest. And the amazing thing is that when John sees him, he sees him in the midst of the lampstands. And if we go to the next chapter and we look at what is said to the church of Ephesus, we'll see that a little description of Jesus is given to the church of Ephesus that they need to focus in on, to hear what God is saying to them specifically as a gathering of God's people. And the way to interpret it like this, to read where you read this, verse 2. To the messenger, chapter 2, verse 1, to the messenger of the church of Ephesus, write these things, says he, who holds the seven stars in his right hand, and who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. Did you see that some new information here that we didn't get in chapter 1? In chapter 1, he was just in the midst of the lampstands. Now in chapter 2, we've got some extra information. He's actually walking in the midst of the lampstands. See, the Greek word peripatio means to walk around. Patio is to walk on, you know, like your concrete patio outside your house. And perimeter is around, and peripatio means to walk around. What John sees is he sees our great overseer, our great bishop. He sees the one who is scrutinizing the lamps. He's watching. He's walking in the midst of the seven lampstands. He's looking in each one. And if you know how this follows on in the next two chapters, you know that to every single one of those churches, he begins it fundamentally in the same way. The first thing he says to them, I know. That's his first statement every single time. I know. And he knows because he's walking in the midst of the lampstands. He is not an absentee landlord. And he's walking in the midst of our absence. The churches that you are part of, the high priest takes responsibility for the testimony. The light of his character is to shine from that place. He takes personal responsibility. He will come and he will trim your bell. And he will supply your bell with oil. It's his responsibility. It's not yours. It's your responsibility as individuals to respond to him and to bring your offerings to him, to have your quiet time with him, to beat hands as you wait upon him. The oil, so this oil, when you present it, you put it into the hands of the high priest, and you say, there it is, Lord, but it's not my job to replenish these reservoirs. And it's not my job to trim these lamps. It's the job of the high priest of Jews. Now, why do you think Jesus would give such a revelation to John? John's on an island, he's far away from these things. Maybe he begins to think, if only I could get to Ephesus, if only I could get to Sardis, and I've got a word, I've got to speak to that one. It's just, sometimes when people are given places of responsibility and honor in the Church of God, it can happen to a man that he begins to think that he is indispensable. It sneaks up on somebody. And you know, it's the Elijah syndrome. And I only, I am left. And if anything happens to me, then the whole thing is sunk. It's finished. There's a little phrase, if you remember, when Elijah actually calls upon God to take his life away. And Elijah said this, that his life, purely a sense of humor, no doubt, that kind of sees this. But Elijah says to God, take away my life. I'm no better than my fathers. And I feel like saying, well, who said you were? Who said you were better than your fathers? When God puts responsibility into a person's life, it's very easy to move to this level where you think, nobody's seen it quite the way I see it. No one's got the power I got. No one's got the responsibility. I am left. When I'm gone, this little church is going to die of death. Well, yes, it would do if it depended upon you. But praise God, it isn't. It's a high priest who's responsible for the little churches. And they don't need to put me together in his name. For there to be a little church in that place. And for it to have personal, daily visits from the high priest to see how it's doing, to see what's needed, to see if it's begun to smoke and it needs to be trimmed, to take away things that have burned and had their days, and needs to be cleaned away so that the light can be absolutely clear and unflickering. It's his responsibility to continue to supply the oil. When Paul wrote to the Philippians, he begged for their prayers. He said, I know that this shall turn to my salvation through your prayer and the continuing supply of the Spirit of God. Not just one baptism, it's a continuing supply. Praise God for one baptism. But the high priest comes to make the supply continue. Let me go to some of these parts. It talks about these seven men, seven messengers who are in the right hand. They're his messengers. As to say, he will charge these people with words of grace to bring to the churches. And it's not necessarily big, one-hour-long sermons. It may just be a simple word of prophecy, a revelation. It may be some truth. It may come through someone that's never brought a word like that before. It might be one of the youngsters who says, can we sing this hymn? And there's some truth in that hymn that somehow catches the heart, in a sense. And what's happening is that Jesus is using his messengers. He's bringing his word into his church. He's bound to do it. He is committed to do it. He is honor bound to continue to care for the little lampstand.